get food. We are the largest producer of milk in the country. We are the largest producer of milk.
Mm-hmm.
But even milk, you can only drink so much, you can't eat it. So we came in and we started a food security program, which we have rolled out, and we have been issuing subsidized seeds, sometimes free seeds and fertilizer to our farmers. And I can tell you, I can invite you for a field trip today to Gatondo, Gatondo South, Gatondo North, to Githunguri, and you see some of our farms, and you see the kind of food and maize particularly, and tomato, potatoes that farmers are producing. And you will say, yes, I think we are at a transformational stage as far as food security is concerned. You know, when you go to the periphery, the areas like Goliva, Gatuanyaga towards Kirimambogo, on they are, you know, they are just next year, you see that those places people have been actually suffering as much as they have been suffering in Ukambani and other areas. And but we are in at a point where we are transforming that. We would want them to have their own food by getting the right technologies and making it a fair, affordable. So we have a very clear plan of what we want to do as far as enhancing the food security is concerned.
Right.
The second one is the crops we have talked about, coffee, tea, dairy. There has been nothing that has been done in helping farmers to come together. With all the regulations that are now coming up, even including dairy, the fact that we are the largest dairy producer in the country, a lot of that has been done, and you know, in private hands, in places like Githunguri.
Yeah.
If you ask Githunguri to what extent the previous governments have supported them, you'll be shocked. And we have come in and we are supporting those large dairy cooperatives, Githunguri, Duberi, Remuru. We want them to be at a very high level and not only process, but also market and provide services to the people.
Okay.
But we have also sat and said those are only probably contributing about 40% of milk production in the county, and therefore the 60% is from small cooperatives, very very small. And what they need is a cura, a pasteurizer, maybe to be assisted to transport milk from farms, to provide extension services. And that is what we are doing now. We have put together the 23 small cooperatives into an association which has been registered officially. And what we are doing is over the next 3 months, we will be identifying and procuring the facilities to make sure that they collect the milk quickly, they chill it, they pasteurize. And initially, we are entering into a discussion with KCC, with Brookside and others to come and collect this milk as we think about setting up our own milk processing plant. So that has not been done before, and we are doing it now.
Right.
If you look at coffee, we produce very high quality coffee. Our coffee is very, very known for quality from certain cooperatives like Getwe, Komodai, and others. And the plan now is to make sure that we have a county mill. Unfortunately, we didn't have a county mill.
Right.
We are entered into negotiations with Komodai to see if we can make Komodai a county mill so that we mill centrally and market. We are in discussions with the U.S. government because we are a partner county. We are the only partner county appointed by American Chamber of Commerce in the whole of Mount Kenya region.
Okay.
And we would want to enter into processing and marketing of our own coffee in the US, in Italy, in other places. So those are things that we are looking at in order to enhance that economic empowerment. But remember, 60% of our population is young people.
Right.
And they will not be involved in all the things that we have talked about.
Okay.
We would want them to get involved, particularly in processing. We would want them to start getting involved in, marketing and domestic consumption of coffee.
Are there channels to incorporate them?
Well, yes, we would want to. And when we talk about coffee, we are also looking at enhancing coffee consumption so that we bring the young people together and they can open mobile coffee shops in areas like Thika, even Nairobi. So we are thinking about that. But I wanted to come back and say, even before they get to that, even into manufacturing of yogurt for local use, that there are several other innovations that the young people are involved in, and small and medium enterprise. But we've realized that the biggest constraint is working capital. You know, a young person will not be able to afford 150,000 shillings to start a car wash or to start a salon or a garage or whatever, or, you know, a greenhouse. And that is where we have come in with the arrangement you are talking about with KCB, where we are using small bits of our money in order to leverage for big monies in the bank. So we have come in and we have entered into an agreement with the bank to say, for every young people, every entrepreneur from Kiambu who comes to KCB under this arrangement and will take a facility, they will not pay 13%. They will pay 7%. Mm-hmm. We, the county, will subsidize the 6%.
Mm-hmm. Any now, criteria? Any criteria? Or you, like you rightfully put it, it's anyone who's young and comes from county.
No. What we are saying is that, and people should get this very clearly, is that people must pass through the bank. The bank will have to do their own due diligence.
All right. Okay.
So it's not just a question of coming in and we give you a compliment note to go and get this money. No. But I'll come to that in a moment. So the first thing that we are doing is to subsidize the interest rates from 13 to 7%. The second thing we are saying is that you don't require any security. Will be your security. So that if you want to start that car wash, all you need to do is to know how to do car washing, but also to find out a place, and you go and you get your facility. You not be asked for any security. Nobody will ask you for a logbook, or nobody will ask you whatever the other securities that they are looking at. Mm-hmm. But more importantly, Lina, is where you are coming at to. Is it everybody? What we are doing, and we are starting off this at the end of this month, we will launch when we are celebrating the one year in office, is to start a unit that we are calling Business Development Systems.
Okay.
Business Development Service. Now, that is a unit where we will be asking people, young people who are interested in establishing car washes.
Yeah.
They would come in and would have technical people who would train them on washing cars. You may think that washing cars is just getting water and soap. And then they would be taught business. They would be taught marketing. They would be taught all of those aspects. If you want to open a salon, we'll get a cohort of people who will come and they'll be trained what it is like to be a good, salon attendant.
All right.
What you require, the hair blowers and whatever. And then once you have gone through that and you have been taken through a lawyer, on documents that you require to register your business, to register KRA, the commitments that you need to make, we will then recommend you to the bank, and then you go and get the facility from the bank.
All right.
So that is what is going to make a difference, even in terms of Boda Boda and others. So we are moving step by step. We bring in people. We take them through Business Development Service. And then once they graduate, we now recommend them to go and apply for the facility.
Mm-hmm.
And then we will have a group supervising to see that, business. Because, like, for instance, if you are starting a car wash, some of the marketing tricks is that we could tell your clients that for every 5 car washes, the 6th one is free.
All right.
And you introduce a card.
Yeah.
These are things that our people have not done before. So this is what we are looking at.
Okay.
And the 1.3 billion that we are leveraging on KCB is only a tip of the iceberg. It will depend on how much money on our side we have to further subsidize the interest rates and start guarantee. So This is very exciting. I'm very happy about this, and we will discuss about it more.
All right. Well, thank you so much. And I know there's so much that needs to be discussed in regards to that, and generally the development in Kiambu County, and also the timelines, because you realize that we are headed to an election, and then we'd certainly expect that whether the next government is going to be, you know, a government that will be led by you or somebody else, such programs are going to be felt continuously for the benefit of the people. But away from that, we do not go. We have about 10 minutes to go, or even less. We do not go without discussing BBI, what it brings to the table for the people of Kiambu, for devolution at large, and why it is that you have joined the bandwagon, and what do you suppose, you know, the BBI has in store for you as a leader, because then we've also been talking about this regional governance and all that. So generally, what do you make of the BBI conversation and the developments that we witnessed today, especially that one on the central region, or the Mount Kenya region, coming from Senator Irungu Kang'ata, who says that the document is not as popular as one would want to imagine in this particular region?
Well, thank you very much. I have my own views. I have my own views on BBI.
Yes.
I have my own statistics that may not necessarily agree with what Senator Kang'ata was talking about. He was talking about Muranga. I come from Kiambu. I was involved in collection of signatures.
Yeah.
I collected 228,000 signatures,
yeah,
and I know I collected it. I think it is important to know that even at this stage, it is like setting an exam before people have studied. You know, you start with setting an exam and say, this is the exam that I'm setting. Have you passed? But if after that, I'm going to teach you and take you through that course.
Yeah.
You cannot come in at this stage and ask people whether they are pro or against BBI. And yet, you are talking about, we were talking about starting town hall discussions so that we can expose to people what there is in BBI. I think for me, it is completely premature to come and say that it is unpopular. What is unpopular? What have you sold to the people? Okay. What have you told them? Leave about the rhetorics of, I don't know, this is about leadership and about whatever. What we are looking at is the content. What we are looking at is what is in stock for the people of this area. And therefore, I totally disagree. I do not, and you know, we as governors from Mount Kenya region, the 10 of us, came out and said we disagree with that, because that was completely premature. And I, like I said, is setting an exam before you have studied for it.
All right.
Yes, go on.
No, no, no. My question then would be, don't you think it's cause for alarm? There's need to equally look into what it is that he raises, because he argues there are pertinent points, and based on his own special analysis that has been done on ground, and actually opens, you know, the floor for more to be done in terms of, you know, just trying to collect this data and statistics in terms of popularizing the document. Do you suppose you've done enough, and generally the government or the proponents have done enough to make sure that this is popular, especially to the people of Kiambu?
No, we haven't even started, and that is why I'm saying that
you have the luxury of time.
It is, no, Arinda. This is January 7.
Okay.
I mean, we quickly rush to get signatures so that the process can start.
Okay.
And we said it categorically. If you remember the program and the schedule that was produced, that come January, we are going to be involved in town hall discussions.
Yes.
With the people, so that we can offer the people what there is in BBI, and you can ask them to ask questions. It's only 7 days from the beginning of the year. Therefore, it is true that we need to tell people. Remember, even the 2010 Constitution, people did not necessarily understood it. People require even elections. We are getting to elections in 2020.
We got 2022. Governor, we got so much trouble. Just because people were not able to go through the 2010 Constitution, and that is one thing that we really want to run away from. That we call upon Kenyans to ensure that they read the document, because as they make decisions, they should be, you know, informed decisions based on what it is that they have picked within this particular document. So it will be an undoing for us to have our people go out there to vote either yes or no without having gone through the document. When we talk about the aspect of this, and we're talking about COVID-19 and the fact that it's going to be limited to town hall sessions, historically, you know that some of these processes really require proper heating of the ground, which is going to be limited. When you talk about the fact that it's only 7th of January, don't you think this can be an undoing if it is taken lightly?
Linda, if you want, you can do civic education for 1 month.
Okay.
If you roll out, I mean, how much time do we have in civic education when elections are done? Okay. Remember, in the last election, it was the first election where 6 ballots were to be marked by one person.
Mm.
And we did it. We did civic education. So we can do civic education. If we stop spending time talking about how we would do civic education and actually spend time doing the actual civic education, we will have a lot of, I really fully appreciate that this is a very, very difficult time. We are talking about COVID. Now the children have gone back to school.
Yeah.
We are watching to see if the infection rates are going to increase. We are also looking at resources. Counties are finding it difficult to access resources from the national government. So it's a difficult time.
Yeah.
But it does not mean that we have to. There will never be an appropriate time. And we as a country must realize that there are certain problems that we have lived with that we have to sit down and agree that there are problems in the country.
Mm-hmm.
Some of these problems have to do with our own internal security. It has to do with the economy, that our economy is cyclic.
Mm-hmm.
Every time you enter into an election year, the economy dips, and then it peaks 2 years after the election. This, if you look at statistics, it will show you that wave. We also have, as a country, must recognize the fact that we are in campaign 24/7 for 5 years.
Yes.
The election date, finishes today, and tomorrow we are either in government or campaigning. The resources that we are using to campaign could go towards development. And we as a country must sit and say, can we finish one election once and wait for another 4 years when we are doing economic development and then do the campaigns and election in the 5th year?
Uh-huh.
As a country, we have to be real to ourselves. We are living with certain problems. Why are we the only country in within the region that still suffers from food insecurity? I mean, Rwanda came in the other day. They are food secure. You know, we are spending close to $3 billion to import food that otherwise we can produce from outside.
Mm-hmm.
As a country, we have to pause and stop pretending and say we are in problems. We are in trouble. We have a youth budge. How do we ensure that we stabilize our economy immediately we finish our election on the 9th of August 2020, that we concentrate until 2026 so that we can create jobs for our own people?
Right.
Why are we pretending? This is the provision. This is the time. This is what BBI is providing us.
Okay.
I agree that we may need to pause and say, have we included everybody?
All right.
Do we have all the issues? I agree. I totally agree with that. But people who are coming in to say this is not the right time, it's probably not the right time because we want to remain as a country that is impoverished and is a country that cannot provide jobs for its people.
Well, Skiambu, Governor Honorable James Nyoro, thank you so much for the great insights. Also, what it is that you're doing for the people or for your people, as of course they have lots of questions and they hope that indeed all these dreams are going to be realized. We might have, expounded some more, but then again, time is not on our side. But then that is to mean again, we will invite you, I hope, to have you some other time as we expound more on the national politics, on the growth of devolution across different counties, and just how much we can ensure that the dreams of devolution are certainly realized. As many would say, devolution is probably the best thing that would have happened to us, only and only if we get it right. That's where we get to wind it up. Mheshimiwa, thank you so much once again, as we wish you a lovely day ahead. And also you back at home, thank you for keeping us company and also for the great feedback. We'll be sampling that later on the day. Remember, we still have so much coming up your way as we discuss matters of private sector, that is the private schools, and just how much of challenge they are having at this point when students go back to class, and what needs to be done towards ensuring that there's a recovery strategy that will keep the, you know, private schools, which are very instrumental in the education sector, afloat. And that is after this break.